You are the fat tail. I'm the fat boss.
You got that shit on camera? Nice
one. I'm off to the bathroom to cry.
You were the fat tail.
Bill. May all your
That's really funny, be blue.
Bill, you didn't realize we're like the only three people in the fucking
whole building. I don't find that funny. May all your
SP be blue.
While I got you guys here, can I ask you a question on camera?
Yeah, go for it. Yeah.
Have any of you ever heard of the Zeitgeist Movement?
No.
The Zeitgeist Movement advocates a removal of the monetary system, not a removal, but advocates that the monetary system is corrosive. And it's not a vehicle for equitable resource distribution, it's a vehicle for totalitarian division and control. Your thoughts?
How are you going to buy cornflakes?
How are you going to buy cornflakes with no money?
Yeah.
The idea is that the technical reality.
We're going to have cornflakes. We're going to make them ourselves out of corn.
Yeah, but how do you define efficient ratios of exchange? Well, that's what a price is.
Well, obviously, you barter.
You barter. Fucking barter. That's your solution? Tell me that's not your solution.
No. The idea is that the technical reality of us is that we can feed and house and medically care for every person in the world, and that money is an oppressive force that stops that from coming about.
Money is a counter, right? It's a way to affect distribution. So
money is a cancer because it only
replicates. It's not a cancer.
No, but it is a cancer because it only replicates itself with no benefit to the life host. That's the outlook of the Zeitgeist movement.
What?
Take Star Trek.
No.
Take Star Trek.
How does that work?
They've got no money.
And you've got the grab off.
No, the replicator, right?
Yeah.
Because there's no scarcity.
Exactly.
That's the point.
So I think the posit, right, is technological change.
Well,
reaches a point where there isn't, and of course then there's the question
why
gold-plated platinum is worth anything.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, it isn't
the Ferengi under the law of acquisition.
That's right. So why can the Ferengi exist in the world of the replicator?
Exactly. They can't. They shouldn't.
Exactly.
Yeah.
The contradictions of inconsistency.
So why did Tasha Yar die?
That's what I want to know.
It's a mod creature.
It's really sick.
Yeah.
No.
There have actually been.
But counterpoint. In the culture books, there's no scarcity. But there are currencies because some things are scarce, like reputation.
Yeah, exactly. So I've actually read quite a few of the culture books, and one of the really interesting things is that there are different, on the different spaceships, there are actually different economic systems, which is really interesting.
Which track this.
But going back to the Zeitgeist movement, let's say the United States has the Zeitgeist movement, we adopt all your principles, and then a massive fucking hurricane smashes half of New York City.
And the replicator.
The point is, this is the most developed economy in the world. They can't restore power in under a month. They can't pump out their subways. Solve the problem.
Yeah.
No, I'm telling you, solve the problem.
Yeah.
How does the Zeitgeist yoke solve that?
Well, problem solving is basically hindered when you have to budget. So that if there's not that...
Yeah, but you'd still have to budget. I mean, people's time...
Let him go.
And this is the key idea, that value and cost is a concept. You know, and what value means to one person, it means something different to another person. What cost means to one person, you might think of cost in terms of time, in terms of resources, in terms of emotional...
And the wonderful thing about money is that you have a universal medium of account and exchange that allows you to account for those things.
In fact, that is the fundamental theory.
In fact, that's the fundamental point of why we started using money in the first place.
Well, no, so this is a really interesting point. I used to think that as well, that money evolved because it was more efficient than barter. Actually, the anthropological record shows that debt.
Oh no.
So it was the debt actually existed before money.
Yes.
So the interesting thing about that is barter only existed at the margins and the extremes. So debt and credit actually existed far before money
did. Yeah.
So that's actually really interesting.
But we consider that money.
But now.
Now it's money. But back in the day, you didn't count it. You just knew that Bill owed me something because I gave him half a deer, right? And I didn't owe Bill half a deer, right? I didn't owe him the value of it. I just owe him a thing.
Yeah,
it goes a thing. And then if I couldn't pay you back, right?
Do you know
you took my sons. And yeah. That's indentured, and that's how this
all started. Yeah, do you know the things about the white hand, how that worked in Anglo-Saxon?
Yeah, so
basically your thane would be sat there as your wise man who, and actually in Anglo-Saxon England it could be a woman who did this, which is a rite lost in 1066.
The Buddhic stuff,
So, you still had what we would call money because it was debt and credit.
Yeah.
You still had a court of settlement that had to recognise and account for the exchange.
Yeah, but you said it was a unit of account.
Yeah, but the point is, the reason why it's a unit of account is because once societies became complex enough that everybody didn't know everybody else,
So there's a really interesting case study in the Manchester School in the 1982, I think, by a guy called Antoine Murphy. And in Ireland, there was a banking strike. A banking strike where all the banks shut down for an 8-month period. And there was no money. You couldn't access your accounts. And what people did was, the economy was so, there was only 1 million people really working at the time. People just exchanged checks. That we never cashed, right?
Yeah.
It worked perfectly.
Because it was still something.
No, because it was the social capital. I only exchanged with my local butcher and all that sort of stuff. It's a brilliant case study.
With a reputational.
It's a social capital.
This is like the Swedish courts up until very recently just were happy enough to recognise a contract made on handshake.
Yeah.
Because it was accepted under
your good word
ancient laws that you're, that by doing
under US law, a handshake for many ranges of contracts is perfectly.
Mm-hmm. Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
In the
most litigious society in the world, a handshake is a type of contract?
If a lawyer can argue it, yes.
Well, lawyers can argue
it's all. It's all about, do you intend to have a contract?
Okay. All right.
And in fact, you can actually set aside a contract under the ground that there was no contractual nexus, i.e. no intention to form the contract at the time that
it's a written contract. If you're making a joke type of thing.
But that's actually with a written contract as well.
That's a defense. Good luck with that defense.
How would the economy work if there was no money?
It worked like it did in 1971.
No, you're thinking. I already made the banking thing.
I think, let's go back to 40. There was still this thing about the favor swap thing.
Yeah, the favor exchange.
Yeah, that's something that really happened there in, say, from 1920 up to what, 1950, mm-hmm. Much separate, because you had these things called treasury machines. And the treasury machine took 15 guys to run.
Okay.
And nobody hired any people. What they did was, if you were a farmer and you were doing a threshing, the first 5 farms coming into you, you help them, and the next 5 farms after you, you help them.
It's a paid forward system.
It's a paid backward, then you pay it back forward, then you pay it back afterwards.
Do
10 farms during the course of summer. Yeah. Everybody does. And then it runs around the country like that. The thresher does a circle around.
Oh,
that.
Wow.
So everybody helps everybody else.
So who paid for the depreciation of the thresher? What happened when the. I don't even know what the thresher looks like. What happened when the
you have to charge enough.
Extra
bonus days where you volunteer.
Yeah, you probably get paid with wheat. Takes the same risk.
No, but look, I presume threshers have wheels, right? So what happens if the wheel breaks? Who fixes the wheel? The poor fucker who happens to have...
There's a guy who owns the machine.
Oh, okay, right. Yeah. So it's not a cooperative type thing.
It's not a cooperative thing in that way, but the cooperative movement, I think, is a good example. But I don't think that's...
Savings and loans in America often started in ethnic groups where we help one group within buy the house.
Yeah.
He repays the loan. The next person in the group.
Yeah.
That's microfinance. That's the Grameen stuff, is it?
Yeah.
That's the basic.
Yeah, but the problem you have with these systems, they work great when they're small.
Yeah.
But when you get larger,
Mondragon, right? Mondragon is a massive cooperative bank. It's absolutely huge, and it's essentially on the cooperative structure.
But how are it's still used as a unit of account, medium of exchange.
So going back to the
as a matter of convenience, right?
Well, no, this is the thing. It's not convenient. I don't believe the Samuel Sonian thing where money is like a veil of, money has its own. It's a commodity of its own.
Well, you're talking to the choir here.
Yeah.
So my colleagues are modern monetary theorists.
Randy, the lads,
they're very much, as you say, in terms of the history of money and such, and for them, taxes are a large part of the reason,
money makes sense. That's the whole thing, like, whatever the government accepts in payment for taxes,
it destroys money.
Is money.
But it is money.
It is money.
Yeah.
I think the government accepts.
You come to Ghana, mm-hmm. right? And you say, hi, we'd like to give you these pictures of really weird looking people. And they say, well, thank you very much, but no.
Call yourself.
You say, by the way, we run the country now, and you have to pay taxes, and the only thing we accept is these.
And guess what? We're going to pay you in these things as
well.
Well, it's your choice, right? Yeah.
Oh, okay.
When the Cosi, or.
Well, the thing is, you can have no income, and then you've got tax liability. When the Cosa Nostra formed originally in Sicily, they took payment in anything.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, because basically it was a cartel enforcement mechanism, and it took over the roles of state that didn't work, the Aragonese. And, you know, in Sicily what they'd done is they'd absolutely destroyed all social capital to prevent rebellion. So, so firstly, the Cosa Nostra was a pro-social organisation to begin with, but secondly, it had a wider definition of money because it took any kind of payment.
And in terms of banking, your collateral was you.
Yeah. But actually, you did quite well.
The downside is massive.
There's a brilliant article I touched on.
Yeah. And your off
fingers.
Foot. Your
yeah.
off foot.
Yeah.
There's
yeah.
a brilliant article I touched on last night in the Baltimore thing that from Journal of Law and Economics in 1993. Basically, that it was looking at the pasta machine rackets in Chicago in the 1930s. And the point is, if you actually had a restaurant in Chicago at that time, you wanted to be a mob restaurant. Because, you know, you'd get your pasta machine from the mob, but the mob would make sure that nobody undercut you and nobody outcompeted you. So you were quite happy to pay your dues to them.
So this is where Stigler got it off, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, a Nozick, you know.
Wouldn't it be of an unregulated...
Wouldn't it be amazing if that was where Stigler really got it off?
Yeah. You know, Nozick's Chicago State of Utopia. Yeah. It's got the naturalistic account of how you fall into a state without even trying.
Right.
And basically, one of the examples is the Cosa Nostra for how it happens. Yeah.
But I think the thing about money thing and all these systems that are non-money systems like the favor chain stuff like that,
yeah.
it's that they will eventually be subject to gaming.
Yeah.
Someone will eventually game the system, and the one thing money takes away from it is if you go game the system in a very different way.
I was going to say, how far are you going to push this no gaming?
They're being game in very different ways, but it's very much easier to game a system where there's no money. Where, like, you know, Kruger has this example with the babysitting cooperative, where the whole thing just falls apart because everyone saves up their credits.
Well, the only reason that babysitting cooperative, because I read the journal article, the only reason it fell apart was that. They had set the ratio of exchange so that was one for one. And so what people were doing was saving up to go away for a weekend and stuff.
Yeah.
And that was causing a credit crunch, a liquidity problem. Yeah. So all they needed to do was throw out more, they added more people into the babysitting co-op and they printed off more chits and it worked perfectly.
Yeah.
So all they needed was direct.
In other words, there was a monetary crisis in the babysitting co-op.
There was a monetary crisis. And what did the guys do? They printed off more money.
Yes.
Which your zeitgeist guys think is useless, and it created the solution problem.
Yes.
It was a short-term monetary financing.
We just created more washers.
Yeah.
Used washers, green-painted washers.
Green-painted
with
washers.
Sting, you're still...
Well, it was money,
Still on the empty stomach where you
I'm starving. I'm going to go, man.
I'm going to have to throw it, I think.
Yeah, I'm not going to...
Have some to eat when
it's...
I'll...
Social solidarity.
So, yeah.
So, okay, but...